and lying at his door is a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who would gladly have eaten his fill of the scraps that fell from the rich man's table. Dogs even used to come and lick his sores. When the poor man died, he was carried away by angels to the bosom of Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried, and from the nether world, where he was in torment, he raised his eyes and saw Abraham far off, and Lazarus at his side. And he cried out, "Father Abraham, have pity on me. Send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am suffering torment in these flames." Abraham replied, "My child, remember that you received what was good during your lifetime, while Lazarus likewise received what was bad. But now he is comforted here, whereas you are tormented. Moreover, between us and you, a great chasm is established, to prevent anyone from crossing who might wish to go from our side to yours, or from your side to ours." He said, "Then I beg you, Father, send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, so that he may warn them, lest they too come to this place of torment." But Abraham replied, "They have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them." He said, "Oh no, Father Abraham, but if someone from the dead goes to them, they will repent." And Abraham said, "If they will not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded if someone should rise from the dead." The Gospel of the Lord.
Was that he
to notice those around him who were in need of help. Jesus is clearly saying that the rich man went to hell because of this. Now, why was Jesus so concerned about the poor? Why does the Old Testament tell us that God expects us to take care of our poor and marginalized? Well, because when God created us, Genesis tells us that he created us in his own image. So every human being that has breath, that is alive, was created in the image and likeness of God. And then Jesus brings that even further when he says, whatever you do for the least of my brothers, you do for me. Now this is in the context of Matthew chapter 25. Remember what he says in that chapter. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was naked and you clothed me, and so forth. So God says that it is our sacred duty and responsibility to notice those who need help. And furthermore, to share what we have to make sure that happens. Now you might say, what can I do about this? This problem is so much bigger than mine. Well, for one thing, we need to be able to notice those around us who do need help. But in the bigger picture, there's a bunch of stuff that needs to get figured out about poverty in this country. Did you ever wonder where street people come from? See, I had a brother that lived on the streets from time to time because of his mental illness. He was schizophrenic. And that made him unable to function at all sometimes in society. I mean, he had jobs here and there. Sometimes he would do okay for a while. But then his sickness would kind of overtake him, and that was the end of the job. So much of his adult life, especially toward the end, was spent on the street. Now, in former times, my brother would have been institutionalized in a state facility of some sort, where they would try to treat him, and he would get 3 squares a day, and be able, you know, the family could visit you and all that. Well, then came the 1960s, where activists protested for the release of such people because they claimed that these patients were being treated cruelly. And I suppose in some places they were. I mean, we've all seen the movie One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. But rather than deal with the bad apples, and because states were interested in reducing their budgets and their taxes, they gave in to the complaining from these activists, and they just let them out. Many, if not most, of our street people have a serious mental illness, or they are terribly addicted to drugs or alcohol. So what do we do about that? You know, if we really want to tackle homelessness in this country, we had better be thinking about how to treat mental illness and addiction more effectively. That's something to think about, just as a citizen of the country. Or how can we fashion a system that helps people when they really do need help, but does not produce people who become dependent on that help? That's a major criticism leveled at our current efforts to deal with the poor in our nation. And another one is how we deal with children born out of wedlock. I looked up some statistics, and I need to look up a few more. But according to the federal level of human services, in 2012, well, let me have a guess. What was the percentage of all American births, all races, creeds, colors mixed together, that were born to single-parent families? What do you suppose that percentage was in 2012? is 40.7%. Now, in 1950, let's say, when strength and families were pretty strong, most people would say they were healthy socially. What was that number? Around 5%, maybe. For non-Hispanic blacks in 2012, that number was 72.2%. You know, it doesn't take a genius to figure out that children born to a single-parent family are much more likely to be poor. Have you heard that discussed at the national level? We hear all this stuff about income inequality. Why is that? 72.2% of the people in this bracket born to single-parent families almost guarantee a lifetime of not being able to hold a job because they've never had one. Also, people born into that state become angry over the course of their lives, partly because they don't have the direction that a father provides for his children. Have you noticed any anger in our streets lately? So what I'm saying is, if these issues are not dealt with, we are really not helping anyone with our current system. It needs to get fixed. And as Catholics and as citizens of this country, maybe part of the answer to the problem is that we start floating those statistics and awareness up to the top. You know, starting locally, then working regionally, and then nationally. If we could bring that issue to the table in the national discussion about poverty, we could actually make a difference. Now, how it would get dealt with, I don't know. There's a lot of creative people in the world, though. We make all kinds of public service commercials that encourage us not to smoke or, you know, stuff like that. Why couldn't we do something like that with encouraging young ladies to not have babies out of wedlock? Or a number of other things like that. You don't hear that at the national level at all. That needs to change. At the end of this story, the rich man tries to get Abraham to warn his brothers about their fate if they ignore those in need. And he even goes so far as to request that someone be raised from the dead to warn them. Abraham says, they got Moses and the prophets. Even if one should rise from the dead, it wouldn't change their mind. Well, guess what? We, too, have Moses and the prophets. They've been speaking to us for several millennia now. And, in addition, we do have here one raised from the dead. And today the gospel is warning us about seeing the plight of those around us. The question is, will we hear it? Will the Jesus that comes to us from this altar find us recognizing and responding to the poor later today or later this week? Now, some people that are in need today, one class of people, if you will, are the sick and the elderly in our state. Due to the fact that there is legislation coming up before us that concerns them. So, the bishop has written a letter to all the priests of the diocese, and he's asked that we all read this letter this weekend at Mass. So, that's what I'm going to do. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, this November, voters across the country and across Colorado will cast their ballots in national and state elections. Election seasons are an important time for the bishops of Colorado to remind Catholics and all people of goodwill about the importance of forming consciences carefully in the light of the Church's teachings on the serious issues facing our nation and state. These issues include, but are not limited to, the dignity of all human life, religious liberty, poverty, education, immigration, and physician-assisted suicide. The purpose of this message is not to endorse any candidate or political party. Instead, we wish to stress the important responsibility Catholics have to properly form their consciences based on the teaching of the Catholic Church in order to become faithful citizens. This election season is even more important than normal for Coloradans because we are being asked to vote on the legalization of physician-assisted suicide. The people most at risk from this destructive proposal are the elderly, the disabled, those without adequate health care, and the people with little or no support system. In other words, people who pose a cost burden to their family and to the state. This kind of thinking comes from the throwaway culture Pope Francis has warned us about. We implore you to vote no on Proposition 106. Proposition 106 is a dangerous and reckless policy. It is not good for Colorado. Over the course of the next several weeks, this parish will be receiving more information about the dangers of physician-assisted suicide and Proposition 106. Starting next weekend, we will have available to us Vote No on Proposition 106 yard signs, available for you to pick up after Mass. Signs are free of charge, and we ask you to consider taking a sign and displaying it in your yard. Our faith demands that we participate in public life and make our voices heard in the public square. Let us heed this call today and always. Let us stand now.
Thank you.
Westberg and Water Valley Hall created for greater witness speakers in the line we offer you. Through the divine and working human hands, will become our spiritual life. In a similar way, when the supper was ending, he took the chalice, and once more gave thanks to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mystery of faith. commenting on Psalm 3 that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs of eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Thank you. in this heavenly mystery, O Lord, restore us in mind and body, that we may be co-heirs in the glory of Christ, to whose suffering we are united in our holy proclaimed step, who lives and reigns forever. Amen.
Amen.
Last week was the first religious education class at 11 to 12:15. If you have not already registered your children, see Carol Griffith after Mass today, or call her at her phone number, which is in the bulletin. Next week is Food Bank Sunday.